Oklahoma Gardening is a production of the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the land grant mission of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University, dedicated to improving the quality of life of the citizens of Oklahoma through research-based information. Underwriting assistance is provided by TLC, Oklahoma's leading garden center, Southwood Landscape and Garden Center, Tulsa's source for great gardens, southwoodgardencenter.com, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry, helping to keep Oklahoma green and growing. Welcome to Oklahoma Gardening. Today's program is devoted to our friends, the pollinators. We look at research being done at OSU on how to adjust roadside mowing to provide food and habitat for pollinators. We have great plants for pollinator gardens, and we tag monarchs to help researchers monitor their migration.
And joining me today is Dr. Dennis Martin, who is our turf grass specialist and also the lead on roadside vegetative management. Now, there's been quite a relationship between ODOT, the Department of Transportation, and OSU. Can you elaborate on that relationship a little bit, please?
I'd be happy to do so, Casey. The cooperative research project between Oklahoma State University and the Oklahoma Department of Transportation began in 1963. That was shortly after the interstate transportation system was put in. And also at that time, Department of Transportation workers weren't sure exactly what the best vegetation types were for stabilizing roadsides and having good sight distance for motorists. So the first projects focused on vegetation types, and then later the project grew into how to manage those types of vegetation with different herbicides and mowing programs and the types of weeds that were coming into the areas that were vegetated. And then about 1986, the program grew to not only include research, but also outreach training. And it's continued to this day as a research and outreach extension training program between OSU and the Oklahoma Department of Transportation, or ODOT. And then most recently, this year in 2016, with the importance of pollinators, not only honeybees, but monarchs, and then on many, many different native insect species, the project has grown into a research initiative for how to improve roadside habitat for those very important pollinators.
And what we were talking about, the current research, is outside of the safety zone, correct?
That's correct. The safety zone extends essentially from the edge of the pavement out to just a few feet above the bottom of the ditch, and that is usually mowed very frequently so that motorists have the maximum sight distance to give them safety in their travels. But that area outside the clear safety zone, the Department of Transportation has a lot of leeway in how that can be managed to the benefit of not only our general citizens, but also landowners and for pollinators.
Okay, great. I'm going to go catch up with some of your staff about the research. Joining me now is Lydia Calhoun, who's a research assistant here. And Lydia, can you tell us a little bit about the plots and how you've laid out your research here?
Okay, we have 25 monarch plots running west of 51 all the way towards 35 towards Perry. And we are looking at five different treatments with that. The first would be a check plot, which is not going to receive a mowing.
It's kind of your controlled.
Yes, so we're going to be looking at what it would look like without a mowing cycle at all. The second one is going to be mowed as ODOT would typically mow their roadside. So they received their first mowing June 8th to replicate that Memorial Day mowing.
Okay.
The third mowing is going to receive a mowing in mid-July and then late fall. The fourth will just be a mid-July mowing only, and then the fifth will be a late fall after frost mowing.
Okay, and so the variable is the mowing time, obviously, and when you go out and you look at your plots, what are you looking for?
So we're looking at the milkweed. We're looking at how that
like
milkweed
this right here, yeah?
Yes, is responding to that mowing cycle, how long it's taking it to rejuvenate from that mowing and be available to the monarch butterfly when it is coming through for the migration.
Okay. So are you looking at just the Asclepia milkweed plant, or are you also looking for any eggs or larvae?
So we're also looking for any eggs or larvae of the butterflies, of the monarch butterflies that are migrating through. So we're checking both underneath and above the plant, checking for any eggs or larvae as we're going through and scouting our plots.
Okay, so you're visually out here on the ground looking for all of that stuff and monitoring the monarch population.
Yes.
Very good. And with all of this, I mean, we're talking about all the good weeds. Are there any bad weeds that might come out of this?
There are, and there's some concerns that we do have with this study. And if you talk with Clayton Hurst, he'll tell you a little bit about that.
Okay, we'll go talk with Clayton.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hi, Clayton.
Hello, Casey.
So it looks like we have some Johnson grass here.
Yeah, we have a small patch of Johnson grass here.
And this is not a good one we want.
This is not on the roadside anyway. It can have several problems for roadside vegetation managers and the traveling motorists as well. Usually this stuff looks a little drought stressed but now, but in certain places, as we get close to the roadside, it can definitely get up very tall and create sight distance issues, blocking intersections or covering signs. So,
okay.
Definitely cause problems for the motorists, and that's one of the reasons ODOT crews come out and they mow this grass, trying to keep it down at a healthy sight distance.
Okay, so we're looking at how we can kind of allow this Asclepia to grow, but maybe not the Johnson grass.
Correct.
Okay, is there any other undesirables that we have to be cautious of?
So we have several around the state, stuff like musk thistle, but on this site, a particular site, we have Cerisa lespiniza, which would be another invasive or introduced species. This stuff right here probably is not causing any sight distance issues, especially out here in the transition area outside of the clear zone, but this stuff can definitely, like the Johnson grass, it's tolerant to a lot of conditions, soil and environmental conditions, so it grows in a lot of areas and definitely competes with the desirable plants that we're trying to promote out here on the roadside.
Okay, so are you using any sort of control methods on these, or?
So in the clear zone area close to the road, we definitely, ODOT definitely has mowing programs and herbicide programs in place to try to keep those under control. Mm-hmm. But out here in the transition area, it's mostly just the mowing programs that they're utilizing to help keep this population managed.
Okay. Thank you, Clayton, for sharing this. It's really interesting to know that what we think of just as roadsides are actually a laboratory and a symbol of great relationship between ODOT and OSU.
Thank you for your time.
We are here at the Kerr Center in Poteau, Oklahoma, and joining us is David Redditch, and he is the president and CEO of the Kerr Center for Sustainability. And can you kind of tell us about the Kerr Center and what their mission is?
Well, the Kerr Center for Sustainable Agriculture was set up in the mid-60s. And in 1985, it went to a sustainable agriculture organization. And our mission is to educate people on sustainable agriculture in Oklahoma and other areas of the United States outside. So that is what we do here.
And you have an amazing laboratory here, basically, and you're doing all forms of agriculture. But what brought us was your new pollinator gardener that you've installed here. Can you kind of tell us about some of the plants? You've got a great one here.
Yes.
This is the rattlesnake plant.
Yes, this is called Rattlesnake Master. It's kind of a unique plant from the look of it. It works structurally in the landscape because of the leaves and the flower heads on it, which, believe it or not, these are the flowers.
Yeah.
And they don't look like flowers. So, but the amount of pollinators that use this one is in blossom, it's incredible. We see bees, beetles, wasps all over this plant when it's in flower. So, and it's very drought tolerant. It's native. It just handles Oklahoma's conditions.
Right.
And I grew these from seeds collected on the ranch.
Okay.
So this is regionally propagated from seed. And as you can see, it's taken several years to establish. And that's, I think, a key thing with native plants is they take longer to establish than a lot of the flowers we may buy at the nurseries and that. These, you let them sit in the ground for several years. Once they get settled into the location, then they take off.
And a lot of times you might not see foliage growing, but what they're doing is they're establishing those roots.
Yes, and anybody who knows Oklahoma's drought conditions, these plants tend to have very deep root systems.
Mm-hmm. Right, and that's why you've actually propagated a lot of them by seed or by cuttings, because you can't go dig these up. There's no getting that taproot out of the
ground.
No,
digging up a plant and transplant it doesn't work for a lot of these native plants. They really need to either become from a pot-grown plant, or you collect the seeds and propagate them yourselves.
And one you have that's growing pretty well here is a nice little ground cover.
Yes, this has kind of been recommended as a trial for a ground cover. This is called yellow puff, and it's related to cat's claw sensitive briar. If you touch the leaves, they actually close up like a sensitive plant would. And it is native to prairies in Oklahoma. And as you can tell by the structure, it's a legume. Very feathery looking, puffy by the name, flowers on it.
Yeah.
But they're attractive to small pollinators. I've even seen honeybees on it.
Now, it doesn't have the thorns on it like
No, and that's the thing. Cat's claw sensitive briar by its name has thorns. This has no thorns on it.
Okay. Great. We don't like thorns all the time. Another great yellow puff flower is your Hypericum here. And this is a native again.
Yes, shrubby St. John's wort. And you need to be careful when buying them because there's some introduced species that can be invasive. But Oklahoma has several native Hypericums, and they work great in the landscape. They're very tidy, they're very tight structured, and they have that yellow globular flower on there that's attractive to pollinators.
And a lot of times you'll hear some of these plants and they might sound familiar names when you've gone to your drugstore.
So. Yeah, from the herbal perspective, a lot of them have some herbal uses to them. And so that's what's kind of neat, the history of these plants when you read about them, what they were used for. So we're adding a little of Oklahoma to the landscape.
Right, right. Well, I see another one that's one of my favorites. So this one is past blooming right now. But we've got this amorpha here, and can you tell us about it?
Well, this is a shrubby. It's related to the lead plant, which I love the lead plant in the landscape. But this one gets taller. It has more like a shrubby tree-like structure to it. It likes wet areas. Mm-hmm. It is a legume, blooms early in the spring. And again, the flowers are very kind of a pale color, but they're striking on the plant. And this one, I collected the seed on the ranch again. I propagated this from seed. And it's turned out to work very well. It kind of gives that woody aspect to landscape. One thing about establishing this native plant landscape was to give people a place to go to see what native plants look like in the landscape, but also to promote the idea of including them in wildscapes for pollinators. And some of the struggles I've had with establishing native plants, dealing with Bermuda, Johnson grass, crabgrass, getting native plants established, so I started looking at shrubs and trees that are native. This is one of the shrubs that seems to be doing very well, and I would recommend it to someone who has had a wet spot or an area low-lying that they had, that if they're going to deal with Bermuda grass or something in an area, this could outcompete and provide pollinator habitat.
That's great, and it also adds a little bit of height to your landscape. Another plant we have adding some height here is the giant coneflower.
Yeah, Rebeckia maxima. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a very, has that almost, the when it's growing in the spring, it has the look of a hosta on the bottom. But then it shoots this big long stalk up, and then it has the yellow rays on the bottom, and it has the seed head above it. And it's a dramatic plant landscape. I'd be careful not to overdo, put too much in,
right.
But it's like a specimen plant.
Yes.
And it works really well in that role.
Yeah, and it's one of those that will surprise you once it starts shooting up.
Yes.
But birds actually like to sit on these also. So if you're a bird watcher, it gives you that opportunity to see them. We've got another ground cover here that's just taking off. And I love the name of it, frog fruit.
Yes.
But it has a little bit of a, like a verbena almost, like flower to it.
Yes. This one is what I call bulletproof tough as nails. This thing will take downpours, torrential downpours. It'll take hot searing heat. It blooms constantly all summer long. And most people are looking at pollinator plants that attract the big pollinators like honeybees. But this one attracts those, but it also attracts a lot of little pollinators. Mm-hmm. And you have to kind of stand here and look at it, and we can see all these little pollinators just flying around all these flowers.
Mm-hmm.
But it provides a continuous food source all summer long for those pollinators. It is seems to be a little aggressive in a landscape, so that's something to be aware of if you're going to plant it.
And one thing you mentioned about when you're designing for a pollinator garden, kind of your rule is to have 3 blooming plants each season.
Yes. And that's because in the spring, you've got the bumblebees coming out of hibernation, the honeybees are taking off. You need that initial food source. During the summer, of course, you need it. And then when you move into the falls, pollinators like bumblebees require the queens have to build up fat reserves. What they need is plants that are blooming in the fall, such as asters and goldenrods, to give them that food source so they can survive through the winter.
So what I like about this garden too is that you've incorporated some of your ornamental grasses as well, which are important to keep that balance for those pollinators.
Yes.
So let's talk about some of the grasses here. You have little blue stem, and you have a really great switchgrass over here.
Yes.
Let's take a look at the switchgrass here. It's called Dust Devil.
Yes.
Is the cultivar. Can you tell me about it?
Dust Devil is, it was selected more, it looks like, for more of the leaf color on it and the clumping aspect of it. And every spring I cut this back. I don't know why we use a lot of pampas grasses in that in landscapes, but to me, our native grasses have a tremendous potential mm-hmm. that's overlooked in Oklahoma landscapes and elsewhere in the United States. I don't understand why we don't use more native grasses, but the key is selecting for plants that maintain an upright habitat and stay in that clumping effect. And it also is beneficial to, in Oklahoma, we have a whole series of butterflies called grass skippers. And the larvae require grasses, and switchgrass, Indian grass, little blue stem, big blue stem are the food sources for the larvae. So it benefits pollinators in the sense that it's a food source.
So David, the Kerr Center has done a lot of research and you have some information. Where can our viewers find that information?
Well, they can go to the Kerr Center's website. We have the publication that dealt with all these landscape plants here on the property and some other publications about bloom times and also resource lists for people if they're interested in doing their own research, different publications, websites, and what can work for them in their area of Oklahoma.
Excellent. We've talked a lot about monarchs this season, and now as we enter into fall, we want to focus on monarch migration. And joining us today is once again Dr. Kristen Baum with Integrative Biology. She's an associate professor with that department. And Dr. Baum, what can you tell us about the monarch migration?
Well, we're starting to see monarchs moving through Oklahoma. I mean, usually think of peak migration being at the very end of September, so usually around the 29th or 30th, but there's usually a 10-day window on either side, so it can be early or late depending on the conditions throughout the monarch's range each year. And then, of course, you'll have some stragglers coming through as well, so it's really a much wider time period. But we're starting to see some activity this year.
And the temperature and the wind, everything goes into that, right? It influences the timing.
It does. And so in terms of the cues for the monarchs, the temperature and the day length and factors like that are what triggered them to start that migratory process.
And why is this an important time for you in your research?
Well, we do a lot of tagging, so it's really important to know kind of the movement of the monarchs, and then of course how many are making it to the overwintering grounds and where they're coming from. So tagging monarchs throughout their range is really important. And so we're out in force trying to catch as many monarchs as we can and tag them as well to see what Oklahoma is contributing to monarchs.
And so what is involved in this process of tagging monarchs?
Well, I caught a few monarchs here at the OSU Botanic Garden a little bit earlier today. I have a glassine envelope, which is just kind of a wax paper envelope mm-hmm. that we keep them in sometimes if we're going to collect a few to process.
And that doesn't harm them, it just keeps them so their wings don't get beat up.
It right? does, and then the kind of waxiness of the paper helps with that as well. So we've got a male monarch here. And
how do you know he's a male?
If you look at the hind wings, they've got this spot on the hind wing that indicates that it's a male.
There, that little.
Right there, and you mm-hmm. can see it on this side, but it's not as obvious, and so until you're kind of used to working with them, it kind of helps to look at both sides. But this is a male monarch, and so for our research, we'll collect some data in addition to what we need to collect for Monarch Watch. So Monarch Watch is the organization that provides the tags, and anybody can order them. And we have ordered quite a few this year, so I hope you are able to tag all of the tags. And so for our research, we measure the size of the wings.
Okay. And you use this tool? What is this tool?
So these are digital calipers, and so they just measure length for us in millimeters. And so we'll measure the width of the wing. And so wing size could factor into how well they do on migration. And so knowing of the ones we tag, kind of additional information about them can be very helpful as well.
Does that play into their age also? If they're a younger butterfly or... Do they come out of the chrysalis being the size that they're going to be?
They're the size they're going to be. Okay. And then we provide an estimate of kind of the condition of the butterfly. Mm-hmm. It doesn't really give you an idea of age, but it could certainly give you an idea of how much they've been through in their life. And then we record the activity. So in this case, these were nectaring on some nice nectar plants at the botanic gardens. And then we collect a tape count sample to test for OE. So OE is the abbreviation for Ophryocystis electroscura, which is a spore-forming protist, which sounds really complicated, but essentially if the butterflies are infected, it means they don't live as long and they can't fly as well. And so they're likely not going to make that migration to Mexico.
Okay, so it's a spore that actually does harm to the living butterflies.
It does. So it most of the time doesn't outright kill them. If they're really heavily infected, it could. Mm-hmm. But it you know, by decreasing their lifespan and their flight ability, it can have a negative effect on the overall population. And then when the females oviposit, they'll leave behind spores, which is how the infection continues. And so there's lots of interest in knowing how those levels vary among years and then with different regions and my interest is land use and management and things like that. And there's a really simple way to test for OE citizens can contribute as well. There's a project called Project Monarch Health where if you contact them, they'll send you fancier tape than this. This is just Scotch tape. And if you just gently press it against the abdomen, it'll pull off a few scales, and then if there's spores, it'll pull those off as well. And the butterflies lose their scales over their lifetime anyway, so it doesn't harm them and lets us release them. So it's a really easy way to be able to collect data and then also let the monarchs go so we can tag them at the same time. And so we'll go back and look at this under the microscope.
Okay. So it's like a little slide that you can put under the microscope.
It is. It works well. And then the last thing we're going to do to this guy is we're going to put a tag on him. And so the tags have a three-letter and three-number code, and so I'm just going to write that down here. And then you have to kind of carefully remove the tag and manage not to get it stuck to you at the same time.
And where do you put it on the wing of the butterfly?
It's this big cell in the center here, which is called the discal cell. So it's the one right there. Get it on there, and then you hold it for a few seconds just to make sure that the glue has adhered to the wing well.
And our little guy's cooperating there for you.
He is. And then there's been research to document that it doesn't harm the butterflies and that they can still fly well. And then, of course, there's lots of tag recoveries.
And there he goes.
So
that's all there is to it.
That's all there is.
Now, the measuring of their wings is something you're doing for your research and also collecting the scales. If citizens or school groups wanted to do this, is there a project where they could get involved in this also?
So they can order tags from Monarch Watch, and they will get sheets of 25 tags, and you can order different quantities. And then they have a data sheet for you to fill out that provides the date, the location that you're tagging monarchs at, whether it's a male or a female. And they've got excellent instructions that come with it as well. What number you're tagging it with, and then you can either send in the paper copies or you can put it in a spreadsheet and email it to them as well, and then they'll post the tag returns on their website in the spring once they get the tag returns. So they'll contribute money so that locals in Mexico, when they find tagged monarchs, they can report those tags, and so that's how they're able to report those tag returns.
So how many are you planning on tagging this season?
Well, last year we tagged 500,
and how many did you find out about?
We found out about eight. So that sounds really low, but anything above 1% is really good. So if you're just ordering 25 tags, it might be a couple years before you get a return, but it's great data. It can contribute a lot to monarch conservation. And so out of our 500, we had eight that were returned. And so we're going to try for 1,250 this year.
Wow.
So we'll see how that goes. So we'll keep our fingers crossed. We get to use all of our tags.
So when we're talking about monarchs migrating, how far do they fly and how high are they up in the air?
Well, they can fly over 10,000 feet. So, if they're migrating through really high, they can be difficult to see. And on an individual basis in any one given day, most monarchs are going to fly 50 to 100 miles maybe. But there is one record of a tagged monarch that made it, I think it was 265 miles. So it would be like driving from, you know, Stillwater down to Dallas. And so they can make it quite some distance if the winds are right and, you know, kind of helping them along there. But then if you think about their whole migration route to Mexico, you know, especially if they're up in southern Canada, they can, you know, that's about 3,000 miles. So it's a very long distance, a very long way to go. And they have had records of those from southern Canada making it to Mexico.
Wow. So. Okay. Well, we'll keep our eyes out for those monarchs migrating. Thank you.
Okay.
Cultural events this time of year. Be sure and consider these activities when you're making your plans for the weeks ahead. Next week on Oklahoma Gardening, we have tips for repairing your lawn with advice on when to sow and when to sod, repairing the turf in a sloped area, and we have a high-tech tool that will allow you more time in your hammock this summer. So join us then for more TV you'll grow to love. To find out more information about show topics, as well as recipes, videos, articles, fact sheets, and other resources, including a directory of local extension offices, be sure and visit our website, oklahomagardening.okstate.edu. We hope you enjoyed this video. It's part of our Oklahoma Gardening YouTube channel. You can also find even more videos on our OK Gardening Classics YouTube channel. And join us on social media for great gardening tips, photos, and discussion.